Welcome to the third day of this 5 days faculty development program titled GIS and Remote Sensing, organized by Department of Civil Engineering, Government Engineering College Bilaspur, and sponsored by AICT under AICT Training and Learning Academy, that is Atal Scheme. The topic for this session is Investing in Space, ISRO's Odyssey, presented by Dr. Alok Srivastav, Deputy Director, VR Rao Satellite Center, the lead center of ISRO, and one of our prominent and illustrious alumni of 1986 batch of mechanical engineering. He joined ISRO in April 1987 and worked at different key positions during last 33 years, which includes deputy project manager, and as a distinguished scientist. At present, he is assumed as deputy director of mechanical system area at URSC. He has played a pivotal role as project director in and the prestigious Mars Orbiter project. He also played a significant role as project director during the launch of the 100th satellite of ISRO, which carries 30 core series satellites from across the world. He also played a vital role in evolving the thermal design for two advanced meteorological spacecraft and multimedia spacecraft, GSAT-6 and GSAT. He has published various research papers at national and international journals and conferences, and also published hundreds of restricted internal reports within ISRO. He is not only a prominent scientist, but also an eloquent orator, as we can hear his voice during the numerous launches related to ISRO. So we are truly blessed to have you here for this FDP. We know it's truly very tough for you to find the time. So we are really grateful and thankful to you.
Thank you very much. I will share my presentation. I think it's very tough for me today to deliver this talk, but as a commitment, I will do that, because I can only make one. I remember these four lines today. वो जो मुद्दतों मेरे साथ था, वो जो मेरा दाहिना हाथ था, मेरी जिंदगी से चला गया, मुझे आसरों की तलाश है. Yesterday night, I packed his body and put it in mortuary. I came here to deliver the talk, and I'll be going for the rest of the funeral activity at around 1 o'clock, because I am the key person to arrange the rest of things. This boy joined under me on the first day. Yesterday night, he left me. It's very tough for me. My all missions, he was with me. I taught him everything and wished that he will grow much beyond. But I lost him yesterday. So I pray to Almighty for his soul to be in peace. With that, I'll start. I'm just continuing just because I did the commitment. Otherwise, I was feeling that I should feel sorry from Seema, and I'll go ahead. I know that Seema was my junior and was with me during my 5 years course, and she was very close to me when I was in final year. I'll try to finish in 1 hour, 10 minutes or so. The story begins for the ISRO. What we invested in ISRO in last half century, it's culminating in the form of advanced missions, be it communication, remote sensing, scientific missions, advanced launch vehicles, and so far and so forth. Vikram Sarabhai, sir, was known as father of space science in India. And he had only single objective. When people questioned him, he says that there are some who question the relevance of space activities in a developing nation. We are convinced that if we are to play a meaningful role in nationally and in the community of nations, we must be second to none in the application of advanced technologies to the real problem of man and society. Typically, for my country, space science in today's stage, the entire credit goes to Vikram Sarabhai, sir, whose centenary we completed last year. I was chairman for the celebration in Karnataka state from my center. Basically, if we just look at it, are you able to see the slide?
Yes, sir. It's visible.
Yeah.
First slide is showing, sir, your name is here.
Oh, second slide has not yet come?
Yes, sir. It is not there. If the second slide is visible, I am able to see the first only.
No, sir. Ma'am. That's only the intro portion of the presentation is visible. It the first one. I think sir has to share again. He has to do it again.
Yeah, just a moment.
Sir, while choosing options available in the
yes. Now, sir.
Yes, sir.
Yes, now it is visible, sir. Second slide, yes, sir.
I think I will go in this mode. This was my junior. Eva, are you able to see?
Yes, sir.
So this was how the story begin. And can I go in slideshow mode? You just tell me whether you are able to see.
It's okay, sir. It's quite visible.
Yes. Yeah. So basically, the growth is phenomenal. 1975, Aryabhatta, when it was launched and as a remote sensing and communication as Apple, but down when the bullock cart, you are able to see. From there to Mars Orbiter mission, the top image and bottom is the satellite, assembled satellite Chandrayaan 2. As far as the satellite growth is concerned, and the rocket, small sounding rocket, I'll let you know what is do you mean by sounding, to GSLV, that is the growth. Why is this so difficult to go in space? Basically, the two main problems. One is the pressure, which is 10 to power minus 12 torr, and the temperature is almost absolute zero. These are the typical two challenges when we go to the space mission, because such a harsh conditions make all the technologies very, very difficult to survive in the deep space. And the third, which is very, very crucial, is the highly energized torus of belt around the Earth. The known feature is known as Van Allen radiation belt. It passes through that, and whenever any satellite passes through such belt, it almost spoils the communication or electronic systems. So it's very, very difficult, but still we would like to go to space. The reason behind that is because, like aeroplanes, which is roughly 10 kilometers to around 1,000 kilometers or 400 kilometers where our most of the space stations are there, or 1,000 kilometers where most of the remote sensing satellite, or around 35,786 kilometers where are the communication satellites will be there. These are the type of altitudes from where the global look will be very, very easy, and hence still with all odd situations, people prefer to go into space. This is what I was talking about. Are you able to see that why it is dangerous to go beyond Earth? Yeah, here as you can see that around Earth, there is a torus of highly energized particles through which the satellite have to pass through, and those highly charged particles will sit across on the surface of the satellite, and unequal potential difference causes the spark and spoils the satellite, and hence it's very, very dangerous to go. And that's why plenty of question came. A lot of issues are there. People are suspecting that whether NASA during those days, whether such kind of technologies were there and whether NASA ever gone to moon or Apollo was totally hoax. So that is the kind of environment where we would like to put the satellite. ISRO has grown multiple folds. Typically in the lighter side, I can say 1,000 times. Why do I say that? Because I just now mentioned to you Arbeta, and that time Arbeta was printed in our national currency of 2 rupees. You can see the image here. And Mars Orbiter mission, which is known as MOM, it's printed on the 2000 rupees currency. So the growth is almost phenomenal. If you just look at it, ISRO has grown in all the three areas very phenomenal. One is launch vehicle. We started with the sounding launch vehicles, SLV, satellite launching vehicles, and then we grown for ASLV, augmented satellite launching vehicle, to PSLV, polar satellite launching vehicle, to GSLV, geostationary satellite launching vehicles. That is on the vehicle side, but coming to the satellite side, we had only two typical requirements in the very beginning of our nascent phase of the space missions. That is Indian National Satellite Series, which was mainly to support various three needs, basically, because India being poor country, in the beginning, we were not having a great support from all around, including financial. So we clubbed 2-3 objectives, like one was communication, second was data relay and transmission, and third was weather forecasting. These three objectives were put in the single satellite known as Indian satellite, which was five satellite series known as INSAT 2A, 2B, 2C, 2D, 2E. And I was recruited for INSAT 2A satellite in somewhere around 1986 and 1987 beginning. And the second satellite requirement was for the remote sensing, that is known as Indian remote sensing satellites, and for which you people all are doing the courses, basically remote sensing the entire globe or our identified zone for various applications, which I'll come across. Beginning of Indian remote sensing and satellite communication program, if you just look at it, it started somewhere in June 7, 1979, and November 20, 1981, this was Bhaskara series after Aryabhatta in 1975. That time the TV camera resolution was somewhere around 1 kilometer. We had a various frequency, and then we switched over one side, this remote sensing, another side was a communication side, which was Ariane payload. Ariane was a French launcher, so they have given us support. So one of the payload for us was Apple, so that was the communication satellite beginning. 1980, when SLV-3 became successful after SLV-1 and SLV-2 failed. Then we switched over to ASLV, and ISRO never had any problem, even when people made fun of ISRO in the very beginning. You know what print media used to tell about SLV? Because our used to be failure in the beginning. It was our learning phase. We used to lift off and then it will fell in sea. So people used to call it as a sea loving vehicle instead of satellite launching vehicle. But we never felt depressed, or we continued to struggle. We became a success in ASLV form, augmented satellite launching vehicle 1992. And after 2 years, we have still made it little more powerful and made it as a polar satellite set launching vehicle PSLV, which is bread and butter for ISRO as on today, and made tremendous and so many records. I am sure that you all will be remembering 104 satellites launched in a single vehicle, that is the PSLV. And a still powerful rocket was became GSLV, that is Geostationary Satellite Launching Vehicle. So this is the story of the space transportation. While coming to space infrastructure from the satellite of remote sensing and communication, INSET 1 series, which was support from the Ford Aerospace USA, of the four satellite INSET 1A, 1B, 1C, 1D. But out of the four satellites, two satellites failed from USA and two became success, based on which we had a plenty of black and white communication satellite and weather forecasting those days and data relay and search and rescue operations. So this was about the various satellites and rockets. If you just look at the rocket growth, I have already mentioned to you PSLV to GSLV to now GSLV Mark III, which is much, much powerful than the previous vehicles. Coming to this Indian space program dimensions, as far as the diversity is concerned, basically it is to harness space technology for national development while pursuing space science research and planetary exploration, space infrastructure development, capacity building, to enhance our meet our requirement of our country, whether it's a technical infrastructure or international cooperation, industry, academy, outreach, and so on. Coming to space application, we have a multiple application as in today in the form of Earth observation or satellite communication or navigation. And coming to national imperatives, we have a social economic development, land ocean, atmospheric interaction, and so many responsibility on our shoulders and in the form of transportation I have already talked about. Coming to satellite application, it is Earth observation, be it for the cartography, urban infrastructure planning, oceanography, research, environmental monitoring, and disaster management. For the communication, I'm sure that you will be it is impossible, I will use the term impossible for our generation now to survive without the satellite, because if I turn off one of the few transponders, TV will be off, mobile communication will be off, ATM will be off, reservation will be off, whether it's a railway or air reservation, everything, tele-education, telemedicine, everything will go off. So we cannot think of life in India as on today without the satellite communication. Coming to the navigation, I'm sure that plenty of navigation techniques people are adopting globally. I'll be talking this little later also, but the aviation industry, marine and transportation, agriculture, and the satellite which we are planning in the form of RNS-1J, which our Prime Minister dedicated to the country for NAVIC. So I'll be talking little later of that application. And space science as satellites, that is astronomy, planetary. There are few events which happens in space, like gamma ray bursting once in a blue moon. So if our space lab is continuously on, then we will be in the position to capture them. We have very good strength in space, almost 110 missions, almost close to 80 launches, 10 student satellite, 2 re-entry vehicles, and around 320 satellites for foreign country for 30 days. My dear friends, you may not be remembering, there were days in our own country then where we used to get our grains from USA and those countries. We were so poor to manage our society. But today, we are so capable that we are not only we are launching our own satellite, but launching the satellites for the foreign countries and building the. This entire credit goes to our young scientists, young engineers across our country, and people like you are, really putting heart and soul in learning the new techniques. Coming to space disaster management, which I was telling, it's a typical combination of remote sensing communication satellite. One side, remote sensing satellites prepares the map of flood, drought, damage, hazard zones, and risk map, and then immediately communicates through the communication satellite in the form of various map to the centers, disaster management centers, and from there, the required help goes to various places in whichever form it is possible to do that. evaluation of Indian Earth observation capabilities. You people will be learning all these techniques in much more detail. So I won't go into more detail. I'm just trying to cover the global ISRO's development and whatever we invested in almost 50 years, that is coming forward in a much more powerful tool as on today for our country's growth. We started IRS satellite in 1988. And as on today, not only recently you might have seen RISAT-2B-R2, a radar imaging satellite, which is very, very powerful and does not depend upon weather, it doesn't depend upon the cloud. I'm sure that you all might have experienced in your TV when you are watching at home, the moment it slightly rains, you will be finding that, yes, there is a data loss and your programs will go out of the screen. The reason behind that is the data which is lost due to attenuation, the Ku band, which is a more powerful band signal transmission, which is gets attenuated if the weather, if the cloud is there. But this radar imaging satellites does not worry about the cloud and such things. It simply passes through and it passes the information to us. So we have resource at cartographic application, ocean sat application, megatropics, and combination of all these satellites for various applications, be it land resource management for the crop acreage production estimation, soil and land. I just want to tell you in brief one thing. I remember I was part of the meeting once various politicians gathered in one place and they were demanding that this much money should be given by center budget because this much area is flooded. But then ISRO came into picture and then exact imaging was carried out for that zone and we found exact area, how much is the flooded area, flooded zone. And based on that, you will be shocked to know that more less than 1/25th of the budget which was provided to those states. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, people used to simply demand whatever they used to like it. But the satellite application and the remote sensing, which you people are learning, that has given enormous strength to our country. Environmental or bioresources in terms of the forest cover mapping, forest fire and risk management, biodiversity, and so on. Water resources in our country, geology, minerals, finding ocean applications, weather and climate under monitoring, disaster management, SATCOM application. So there are enormous applications and all this is available in our web portal, which is known as Bhuvan or MOSDEC in NRSC. If you just look at it, it has grown multiple folds from 1969 to 2012. That is definitely in the form of a monitoring at a very basic stage when we are just starting the crop and then middle stage and then growth, complete growth. And we can assess the final quantity, quantify the number, be it a kharif rice or rabi rice, wheat, jute or any kind of thing. But you will be surprised to know that when the first time this was brought into picture, it was for Kerala to find it out, some disease which came in the coconut tree root. And then when after became successful, we started growing into this area also. Wasteland status development for entire country, the area has been mapped in terms of what is our wasteland, how much we are really utilizing, how much it is depleting very fast. All that is totally mapped. It's only because we have a good knowledge of the remote sensing management. National drinking water missions, enormous efforts have gone. Multiple villages in our country which was not having water. We don't want to publicize this, but I'll just tell you that almost 3 lakhs bore well drilled using groundwater prospects map, almost the success rate is 93%. 9,000 recharge structure constructed, and based on that, our water management is feasible as on today using the satellite applications. This is another applications is nothing but potential fishery zones. We call it the PFZ. And as on today, every coastal area, if you just look at it, there will be ISRO centers. People used to go there like ATM and take it out the picture and find it out which zone they should go for fishing so that their yield will be maximum. And this is possible by the application of the satellite. And you see the graph, how sharply the yield has increased using the satellite or PFZ advisory. So this is one of another application. Similarly, our vulnerability, our country, you know, it is almost three sides. It's covered by sea, and north side, it is covered by the Himalayas from where the flood happens. So actually we are prone for so many geohazards, and all this, including seismic and other such things, we are monitoring drought, earthquake, tsunami, cyclones, drought, landslide, and such zones we have already identified, and continuous monitoring will be going on for these things also. And we have also given full support for disaster management. We give complete support in the form of maps, in the form of warnings. And I'll just tell you, I am project director. I'll come for you for that INSET 3D before taking deputy director of our center in the mechanical systems area. I was project director for weather forecasting satellite INSET 3D R and 3DS. I'll show you what is the application. It has really helped our country like anything in saving millions of money and billions of life. Actually, it is a saving in very short, I can say, both human life and money, both aspects. And tsunami, I think I'm very sure that you may be remembering this, that Andaman and Nicobar, how this bottom, left bottom, you are seeing the picture encircled. It was a fully, it was a single, basically a land zone, but you know now it is split into three post-tsunami. This is the image which was taken in 2004. So we have, you can just see a large view of this. Just have a look at there. See, this is the advantage of the our imaging techniques. If you know very well and you can interpret in a much better way, you can monitor pre and post, and you can continuously look at it, how the land is get eaten away by our sea and various coastal area, how the weather forecasting happens and all that. Similarly, in the tsunami, how the relief fund and how they are being monitored, how they are put forward is the application for the rehabilitation and relief scenario in our country in those days. So this is the not only within our country, this is roughly the figure of 2019. We can see state-wise how many disaster management support systems are placed. And not only within our country, we have a Sentinel Asia project where various countries are coming together to give support to each other. And almost like 23 countries, more than 100 disaster events we are monitoring and giving. Just I'm skipping some slides for the saving the time. So we have captured all these events in the web-based information services. You people can just log in and you can have a look. We have a Bhuvan portal, we have NICES portals, natural resources and database. And very recently, our chairman also announced very high quality images also can be downloaded with the from the ISRO's portal. So if you just say communication satellite application, be it speech circuits on trunk routes, TV broadcasting, business communication, mobile satellite services, radio networking, search and rescue, and so on, be it any services in the form of communication, our satellites are supporting them. Almost from the 6 to 7 orbital slots around our India, 48 degree, 55, 74, 83, 93.5, and 111.5. My dear friends, you will be really surprised to know that what kind of terrorism is going on even in orbital slot. I'm really, when I first time came to know, I was thinking, what the hell people are doing it. Some neighboring countries, they will try to, because there is a there is a first come first service base. So like, for example, you have an old satellite which is of not much use. You simply keep it somewhere around, say, 60 degree orbital slot, and that slot is for you. Now, anyway, you know that the satellite is not having any great application and not even usable. But if some other country wants, then they will demand, you give me this much money, then only I will vacate the orbital slot for you. So this kind of activity. So these five, six slots, this we are utilizing from India for various applications from GSO side. That is around 35,786 kilometer. This is one of the satellites and the first of its kind, large, unfurled antenna. Not sure whether young friends will be remembering, but my generation and previous to me, my seniors will be remembering earlier days when only radio communication was there. A large aerial antenna used to come in the form of mesh. So such form of mesh is created in almost like a 6 meter antenna, and our country is working for even larger size for the coming satellite. And so in space infrastructure, if it is bigger, we can have a smaller ground infrastructure for the communication satellite. A remote sensing satellite application, if you just look at it, already I have briefed about all these applications in front of you. So when you learn all the technique of remote sensing, then you will be in a position to model and give very useful information to the society and to the various centers in the form of agriculture and crop, forest and biosources, water resources, geology, ocean and environment, rural development and so on. Similarly, I just now mentioned to you that I was a project director for INSAT 3D and 3DRS. So the INSAT 3D, which is started, I mean, in the very beginning, we had you may be watching that satellite images for the weather forecasting. So that those satellites only just take the cloud motion. I'll just show you how they are being monitored. So we had INSAT 3D, we had a METSAT, which is known after that Kalpana one, after Kalpana Chawla's death. And from there, we have grown from INSAT 3D and 3DR, which are advanced meteorological mission. So you can say this is the kind of payload is there. And through this payload, which is called imager, so it will take image of the cloud. And as the cloud not only goes in the horizontal direction, but it vertically also grows and goes up. So that is known as a sounding. So how that energy from the earth side, it goes on that yellow color, whatever you are seeing it. Are you able to see this imager INSAT 3D slide?
Yes, sir.
You are seeing that scan mirror, which was earlier used to be beryllium mirror, but friends, beryllium is a defense material and our country doesn't have it. So we moved to silicon carbide mirror, such kind of materials. So energy from the red arrows, they fall on the scan mirror. They will be reflected to the larger mirror known as the primary mirror. And from the primary mirror, that is a right side white color, then it will fall down on the green color known as secondary mirror. And from there, the energy will go from the primary mirror, there is a hole, and then it will split into the various channels. Those energies will be arrested and captured in the form of signals. And those signals we get like images. That was about the imaging, but this is now sounding. Similar concept here, but that same energy when it goes, we split into so many IR channels, and this is the information which comes for our help and accurate prediction of weather. This was not there earlier. That's why people, print media used to make fun of ISRO, that if ISRO has predicted that today rain will be there, then don't carry umbrella because rain will not be there. But now the scenario has changed. After this kind of satellites we have launched, advanced satellite, we are not only in a position to monitor the cloud movement horizontally, but also vertically. So when it goes vertically, we are in a position to predict accurately when the temperature of the cloud will be such that rain can occur. So this is advantage. Like I'm just telling you, every half an hour, we take images. So when two satellites are there together, that half an hour will be split into 15 minutes. First 15 minutes here, for another 15 minutes from 3DR. Like that, it will be go on every 15 minutes 24/7, and the cyclone eye can be monitored, so we can accurately predict what will where it will be, where it's going to rain, what is the kind of damage will happen. This is how the images are taken, and advisories are released almost every 15 minutes. So I have talked about the communication satellite, I have talked about the remote sensing satellite, their application, and how do we do the satellites. And then question only comes that really whether that is enough, or for young scientists who are like a brain drain from our country, when they are looking for some really scientific missions, whether we can do something. And hence ISRO started interplanetary exploration. And the first body we gone is the nearer to Earth is the moon. So Chandrayaan 1 was planned. I remember my friends, when first time this mission was planned, and I was given the responsibility of its design evaluation from thermal aspect, I was thinking sun is very hot and moon is very cold. But it is not, so I'll come forward and tell you. So we have done a moon mission, and neighboring to Earth, there is a Mars and Venus. So Mars already, we have completed a maiden mission, which is a unique in across the globe. No country in the globe has got maiden mission as India has. And we are planning a mission to Mom 2 as well as Venus also. That space science, the quest for knowledge is for astronomy purposes, in the form of X-ray astronomy or gamma ray burst, which I was talking about, ionosphere or plasma study, middle atmosphere dynamics, equatorial electrojets. There are so many events which will be going on, and if you don't have your lab in space created, then you will not be able to understand that, and you will not be able to learn anything. Whatever the advanced countries are communicating to you, you will be simply following like a storytelling. So here you can just see that from 1963, when we started in the form of the sounding rocket and is taking a camera, that time, first time when we started the imaging, and we gone for Aryabhatta, SRAW satellite series, then AstroSat. Before that, we had IRS missions for having X-ray astronomies, IRS P3 and SRAW C satellite, then AstroSat. That's the working missions, and it has a really very good finding has provided across the globe. Mars Orbiter mission and Chandrayaan 1 and Chandrayaan 2. So these are the scientific missions. And coming to the navigation, really it's a very good support from a country. You know, friends, you are using Google everywhere, because it's giving very good support. But the moment our Navic gets into, then these services will be available free of cost to you in your mobile phones. Right now, unknowingly, you are being charged for it. A lot of money is going out of our country using, when you use Google, when you use Google Map, a lot of money goes out of the country. So once our satellite comes into picture, then this money will be controlled. Method of navigations, we are having so many navigation methods, which I am concentrating now is the satellite-based navigation. So suppose you are in Bangalore and you want to find it out, want to reach Bangalore, and you can draw a circle of, if you are just say, imagine that you are around 337 kilometers away, and you ask anybody, where is Bangalore? So because you are 337 kilometers, he can tell that much only. So you can draw a circle, you can be anywhere. But the moment, if you know 2 points and somebody tells, then the using Venn diagram, your zone of unknown comes in within that common area. But if you know 3 circles, then you can intersection of all the 3, you can very easily find it out where exactly you are. But this is not, space is not a plane, it's a sphere. So if you just take space, so you need multiple satellites to find it out exactly where you are using this kind of techniques. I'll not go into much detail. We are having constellation of 7 satellite for regional remote sensing navigation satellite, that is IRNSS, where the 3 satellites will be in equatorial and 4 satellites will be in the geosynchronous orbit. Along with that, we have a Gagan application for our aeroplanes monitoring. We have saved billions of millions dollars using our this Gagan application from the satellite communication. I was mentioning to you, my friends, about the imaging satellites. So very shortly, GISAT, which is ready, which I was project director for that before taking over as a deputy director. So here you can say that you can scan from the satellite our entire globe or selected zone. For example, 18 by 18 degree, if you take it, the entire Earth can be mapped, or 10 by 10 zone, or 5 by 5, or you can have a 3,000 kilometer by 3,000 kilometer spot, or even 1,000. So you can do that. So this kind of imaging, you can do that shortly after landing, after the satellite is launched in that zone. And this is the roadmap. We are also planning to have reusable launch vehicles. Now this is slightly, one test is already completed somewhere around 2016, and now by 2025 we will be having a reusable sound launch vehicles. But then question comes, I'll be touching upon another few slides for the satellites which have been flown for the purpose of using remote sensing application for interplanetary exploration. So this is the moon mission. When nighttime we always look at that moon, bright moon, we always feel, are we alone? Where did we come from? What's our destiny? This is basically called Luna by Romans, but moon has really fascinated the man and mankind from eons.
There has been no civilization
on the Earth. Are you able to see and listen the video?
Yes, sir.
So many such proposals used to be there. But my dear friends, do you know that once upon time, was so close to us, it's receding away from us almost 3.8 centimeter per year. It's going away and away. And at present, it's around 384,000 kilometers. It's a journey. If you try to remember 1959, there was a Cold War between USA and USSR. And USSR used to have a Luna missions, and USA used to have Apollo missions. And they, that this kind of Cold War continues up to 1976, unless and until suddenly both countries have stopped any such kind of competitions or sending missions beyond Earth, especially unto the moon, especially to the moon. I want to emphasize on that. Unless and until 1994, when Clementine missions of United States resumes their probe, saying that they found their signatures of water. What is so great about it? And but that this signature was confirmed in 1998 by prospectors when they told that at the lunar poles, that's North and South Pole, there is a polar ice cap. And the entire quest was revived. I'm not going into more details, but there are more than 200 reasons have been documented in the Global Congress where why to go to moon. But many such reasons, which I put it in the yellow letters, their reasons have been documented. And people have found the reasons to go to moon, but then only question came, this is not that easy to go to the moon alone because space missions are too costly affair to be there. Gentlemen, you may be really knowing it. This particular month, two typical things have become news in the space science. One is three astronauts reached by private USA missions to International Space Station, and one disaster happened when the rocket was we lost one Europe rocket carrying two European satellites and almost close to $800 million is lost. So very costly affair. So for the human civilization, global partnership and such that we people come closer for this kind of space missions. And the most surprising, if you have noticed it, that most of the missions which USA and USSR did, that was at the equatorial zone of the moon, north for North and South Pole. Then you may be thinking, then what is so great about it? Yes, South Pole of the moon has basically a South Atkin Basin there. And Atkin Basin, we are in a position to map. Then we have lighter elements there, and we are thinking that there are polar ice caps. This is what I was talking about, the polar regions which was mapped. You can see, my friends, in case you learn all these techniques, which is arranged by GEC Bilaspur under the leadership of Seema ma'am, you will be really able to do all these things using your own techniques and using your skills. So this is a moon mission which was planned. Of course, it has evolved after it was configured and cleared by parliamentarians. And this is the only mission across the globe which carries 11 scientific instruments in single satellite in the Chandrayaan 1. And there was an antenna which was not only communicating from data from satellite to Earth, it was having two, we call it a dual gimbal antenna, DGA. It was having azimuth, that is elevation rotation. This was a fully development within our ISRO. And this red, this blue color, water, cyan color you are seeing, these are the tanks which carries the propellant. These are the solar panels, whatever you are seeing. And this is the moon impact probe, which has our late President Abdul Kalam sir's contribution when Chandrayaan 1 was being reviewed, he told, once we are going there, why not to leave some footprints on the moon surface? So this is that moon impact probe, the top box. And this was dropped on the moon surface. And these are a few payloads from various countries. There are 11 countries I was mentioning to you. That was NASA, then JPL, Pasadena, then Brown University, then CCLRSC, that is Rutherford Ritter Laboratory, the University of Bulgaria, then Max Planck Institute, IRF Sweden, JAXA Japan. I was deputed to Rutherford Appleton Laboratory UK and Max Planck Institute Germany for the purpose of designing their payload by us. So that is the Chandrayaan 1 was launched in the 2008 successfully. And to reach any body, interplanetary body, we have three techniques. We have one is known as direct transfer to moon. If you have very powerful rocket, that yellow color is small sphere, but circle, whatever thing that symbolizes the Earth. At this point, you launch the satellite. And after launching the satellite by rocket, it will directly, by the time the other planetary body comes, you capture here and that's all, job is done. But for that, you need very powerful rocket. Another is the weak stability transfer theory. Like before Chandrayaan 1, there was a satellite called the Smart 1 satellite from the European Space Agency, which was supposed to be by the ion thrusters, plasma ion thrusters, which was to be qualified. And that was going for some other objective was there, basically for study something else. En route, it has studied the moon surface. So what they did, they have launched the satellite from the Earth's surface and allowed it to go in the elliptical path. But by the time moon came, it tried to capture it. And what ISRO follows is what is known as the down one, that is incremental efforts for better results. So this is our Earth, and we launch the satellite roughly 200 to 250 kilometers in the perigee point. And in elliptical path, it will happen. This is known as geostationary transfer orbit, GTO. And then we have elliptical parking orbit. And like that, every orbit when we achieve, then we try to calculate whether we are in the right orbit or not. So incremental approach will be there. We will be go on increasing the apogee height. And after some time, the apogee height will be raised so much that by the time moon travels here, our lunar transfer trajectory will happen. And there will be a point. That point, Earth's gravity and moon's gravity will nullify each other. And then we will give a small kick in the form of a lunar capture at that orbit in 500 by 500 or 200 by 200 or 100 by 100 kilometer. And there we just give a small lamp, we call liquid engine burn, and immediately it will be fired by the ground signal. It will capture the moon. And to get all the data from there, we have those days in Chandrayaan one time, because the distance is roughly 384,000 kilometers, 18 meter antenna itself was adequate. But when we are planning for Mars orbiter missions or even beyond that, we need a still bigger antenna, that is 332 meter terminal installed in this Bailelu near Bangalore for the ground station, that is known as Indian Deep Space Network, IDSN. But for your information, friends, JPL Pasadena has 76 meter antenna installed in their premise, and hence any signal from outer galaxy also, if somebody is sending, those people are in a position to capture it. This is how it happens. Like one of the 11 instruments is like for an app. So when the satellite is orbiting or observing, it can simply capture the images in the form of this hyperspectral imager. It simply captures the imager in the range of 54 band and the result. So all this you will be studying it. Then a question comes is, sometimes you will be thinking, how we will know that where is the iron, where is the potassium, where is thorium, where is uranium, and so on. So what happens is, we know that any body, whatever sun energy falls on the Earth's surface, when it emits or comes out, it will be in the form of fluorescent X-rays, or it will be like some decay gamma rays, it will be coming out. And in case you have got a capability to identify or capture those signals, you will be taking these images, and you will compare that spectrum with the standard spectrum, and you can identify, yes, here is aluminum, here is magnesium, here is a silicon, and so on. So this is the methodology we adopted. And this is how two payloads in high energy X-ray and low energy X-ray. This was high energy X-ray form of 46.5 kilo electron volt using a plutonium lead-210 as the detector to do that. And a Terran camera was there. Mapping. So ND arc based laser was put it down. It was qualified almost like 1 million shot. It was qualified, and then when it goes down and when goes up after reflection, the total time of traverse divided by time, you can find it out what is the total distance. So up and down can be still is. This is from the NASA. Tell about what is the mineral content or mineral resources available on the moon surface. Similarly, there I have seen JAXA, Japan, and it's 30 commercial data. It's very advanced and very This is the mini satellite. This was the instrument which was identified water on the moon surface. This is a low energy. 40 plus was a hex and that 10 kilograms. This sticks from Rutherford Appleton Laboratory. And this is the what all the design you are observing that left side, these changes. This is all designed by me. I was suggested I modified their instrument because first version of this satellite instrument was flown on board the smart one satellite known as DCIXS. DCIXS. And its next version was Chandrayaan 1XS, X-ray spectrometer. So this was, I have modified this instrument completely after discussion with our European scientist, and they agreed, and this design was found successful. Next was the SAR-2 from Max Planck Germany. This instrument also failed the previous version, but became a success here. This design was carried out by Similarly, radom. I was just mentioning to you friends that there is a van. Is it a theory or is it a fact? Just look at it. We had a radom, very small instrument from Bulgaria, and this has put it, and very nice signatures came, and our theory got validated. And I was instrumental in evolving the design of Chandrayaan 1 from thermal aspect and mechanical aspect. You can see that the front side, the moon surface, which we look from the Earth, when we try to map it and when try to image it, the center portion, which is red side, whatever you are seeing, that is known as subsolar point temperature, will be close to 123 degrees Celsius. And the poles or the outer circle will be close to -73 to -90 degrees Celsius. And if you go to rear side, as you are seeing on the right side image, it is close to -176 degrees Celsius. But friends, you unless and until you leave the Earth, you cannot see this -170 from the Earth surface, as you are seeing the bottom GIF image, where you are able to see only front side from the Earth surface. So this is all the satellite. This is how we build the satellite. This is me and my team are watching that my instruments are being put in there. The satellite is being realized here. Very in the clean room, which is a 1 lakh class, and you are seeing me left side in the that image where I'm making it ready. And when the satellite is ready, this is another few minutes. This is the first PSLV rocket. It consists of the pipes. Those pipes, solid state, will be assembled together by one. These are XL boosters. So six boosters, they are there as XL versus the PSL.
And one side, another. Then you will be seeing this. As a person. Now satellite is being lifted. This is myself. I am clearly inspecting the optical solar. After inspection, it is put. And now Chandrayaan shield is, rocket shield is being put. Yeah, the satellite is the fourth stage. Now it's being shifted to the launch pad. That was the assembly building. And when you say you learn or you set the countdown, that is the time at the second and third stage we fill the liquid propellant. Now strap-ons, four strap-ons have been removed, then two strap-ons have been removed, and now first stage will be separated. After first stage separation, now and see that and we are picking. And who is this is how we need.
Sir, your voice is not clear, sir.
Hello.
Yes.
Say sorry to intervene, but the voice is cracking. It's not quite audible.
Pardon?
Say sorry to intervene you, but your voice is cracking. It's not audible to anyone.
There's no voice in the video.
Okay, sure, sir.
Okay. So this is how the moon impact.
No, sir, your voice is also breaking, sir, in between.
So this is how Chandrayaan 1 mission was there. And so this is known as the future Antarctica. We had a Chandrayaan 2 mission where it was a comprising of orbiter like Chandrayaan 1. Along with that, there was a lander and rover. And this was a planned in such a way that there used to be lander and rover. But before really having that technology, it was going to take time because development of lander and rover was there. Initially, USSR, when that time I was not even a project director, I was deputy project director, and I was part of Chandrayaan 2. And Russian has agreed to give us the lander and rover, but later on they denied to us and given that to China. So we needed some time to develop it. So in between, we thought that we will have a Mars mission. So question comes is why Mars only? So basically, that exploring the kind of life beyond the Earth, which we are familiar with. No atmosphere on the moon, but there is a carbon dioxide atmosphere on the Mars surface. Mercury is very hot one side, being very close to sun, while other side becomes very cool. Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus, and Neptune are too far from sun to have any heat of life. And so the only solar system we are left with Mars and Venus. So Mars we wanted to go, Venus is the next. And you can just see that Mars exploration had so many missions, lander and rover, and did lot of imaging. Whatever techniques we learned from this are adopted in the exploration missions. Here also you can see that many missions, but they were near the equatorial plane, not on the polar regions. Many missions, if you just see, actually in the scientific space community, people call it a great galactic hole. The reason behind that is many missions failed. The reason behind that is they failed because of wrong design or wrong capture there. So very less success rate is there. So this is a Mars orbiter mission, which we planned in 2014 after 2008 Chandrayaan 1 mission. So this was, I remember a quote to do that here, Arthur C. Clarke, which was basically a Britisher and died in Sri Lanka. He used to say that any new idea proposed by anybody goes through three periods. One is first impression, people say it can't be done. Second, people say it probably can be done, but it's not worth doing it. And third, once everything becomes success, then they say, I knew it was a good idea to do that. So similarly, that Mars orbiter mission also, because we have only PSL, which is very weak rocket compared to the very other countries, advanced countries. So people told it's a really foolish idea to go using PSLV. And the reason for their Mars and Earth is very, very close to our Earth is inclined by 23.5 degree, while Mars orbiter mission, Mars is inclined by 25 degree. And you know that inclination really, really has a significant impact because all weathering is because of this inclination. And there is a good comparison between Earth and Mars in terms of the atmosphere. And like our moon, Mars has these moons, that is Phobos and Deimos, but not very beautiful like our moon. You just look at Mars moon, and it has got atmosphere. Vertically, it's a carbon dioxide. but not like ours, having oxygen here. And there is a tectonic region which needs study. This is Himalayan is almost one third of this, around 8.99 kilometers height. But Olympus Mons, this is in our galaxy. This is the highest known mountain. Then question comes is how it was created. We want to study that. Similarly, there is a Victoria crater, such a large crater. How it has been created? Then people are talking whether there was a life on the Mars surface which got totally wiped off because of such big impact, which is equivalent to Europe, Asia, and Australia combined. And there is a methane in the atmosphere of the Mars, and carbon dioxide is known. So friends, carbon, hydrogen, and oxygen, when these three elements are there, there is all possibility of life there. There is a theory, there are many other slides, but due to time shortage, I am skipping some slides, how the methane has been created, how life was thought of it, and it's created there, and how to study that. This is the kind of map has been created purely by imaging techniques, which you people are going to learn in this 10-day session. The hydrology, which is important phase of the Mars missions. So this is also very, very important because we are looking for the kind of life which we are having on Earth, but that is not the only life. The life can be in the form of microbes and single cell lives also there. So this is also, and similarly the polar ice cap. In fact, friends, in even this polar ice cap, I told you that Mars is also inclined around 25 degrees, so about its axis. So once it melts, in the seasonal variation, almost the winds will be blowing above of carbon dioxide around 400 kilometer per hour, and it creates a wind storm. And just look at it, those dust storm for the same two seasons, June to September, you just see how that entire Mars is totally covered. And this is one more polyaromatic hydrocarbon which was found on meteorite, which was found on Earth's surface in Antarctica region, that has shown that this kind of elements we find only on Earth. So how it was found there? This is ALH Antarctica meteorite particle which was found there. And there are some particles which are available on Earth's surface that is also there. And also two, three such things are happened where when if we people are not studying this kind of missions, others can only tell stories. When those days in 1976, Viking did the photography, you see left side image. They told that there is a huge alien who is sleeping because it was appearing to be a face. But if you see the right side, now with advanced camera, it is nothing but a just illusion. Arthur Clarke also made a typical statement. He's known in NASA's various missions because based on his sci-fi novels, many of the missions from the NASA and ESA has created. He says that there is a good chance, and he says, I'm quite serious when I say I have a really good look at these new Mars images. Which new images? Just look at these images, which was showing as if water is flowing from one point to another. That is MRO missions was there, Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter. So this missions was showing, and people have told that there are aliens who have created these canals, and people have made the canal maps also. And we will be only listening that these things postulates like a theory and getting fooled. If you don't have your own mission. So we have planned a mission on Mars having a few objectives like design and realization of such missions, deep space communication, navigation, mission planning and management, incorporate autonomous. For common person, it was a mission to go to Mars, but for ISRO, it was a purely scientific mission for the automation point of view. This is how the satellite was conceptualized. The red color, whatever you are seeing, is the liquid engine, which we fire for orbit changing. These are the three solar panels. We generate the power. And these are the small engine, like a Diwali time. We put the cracker. So this also known as a thruster. This is a big antenna called as a high gain antenna, like the three antennas were there. This is the low gain antenna. and these are the star sensor in space, how you are going to have the direction. Here you just see there are various scientific instruments that like Lyman alpha photometer, LAP, Menka payload, which was giving about that exospheric studies, Mars color camera, like there we had a TCC camera, TMC camera, terrain mapping, here Mars color camera, like this various instruments were there. And these are the two tanks outside. This is the helium tank for pressurization, and these are the big tank for the fuel and oxidizer. Two tanks, monomethyl hydrogen and nitrogen tetroxide. Friends, you might have read about the gyroscope in your graduation. These are the wheels which will be rotating and it will be producing gyroscopic effect. These are the five instruments which were made on board Mars Orbiter mission, like this is the Lyman alpha photometer, this is Mars color camera, this is a methane sensor, and this is a Menka payload, and similarly this is a thermal infrared imaging for the night imaging. And this is how we build the satellite in the clean room, how the imaging was done. These patches are nothing but OSR, optical solar reflector, which I was inspecting. These are the reaction wheel, and the satellite was totally assembled. These are the multi-layer insulation, yellow color, which protects the satellite from harsh environment, very cold temperature. When the satellite was fully ready, solar panel were folded and antenna was folded, and the satellite, and this is the high gain antenna. This is also shielded by thermal systems, which we have designed. And they'll be tested. Various kinds of tests were conducted, and this is the large space simulation chamber where we create such kind of environment as the deep space and keep the satellite there and test it for the survival. Then CGMI test will be done, center of gravity and moment of inertia test and vibration test, so that it can sustain those launch loads. This is acoustic test and illumination checks whether solar panel is generating enough power or not, and the kind of signal, radio frequency signal, which is coming from the antenna, which are reaching or not, what is the strength. When everything is tested and finalized, then propellant will be filled, and when the propellant will be filled, it will be assembled like I have shown earlier in the fifth orbit. And typically, if you just look at once in a 26 months only, we get opportunity when the Earth, Moon, Earth, Mars and Sun comes in the single line, shortest distance. That's why we have taken this launch date for Mars Orbiter mission. It was assembled and kept ready, and it was launched on 2013 November. This is real footage of rocket from the launch. And here you can listen my voice. So this was the launch, and I wanted to give you a brief. There was a geocentric phase, and the satellite was injected. It was orbiting around the Earth for the first few orbits, and then apogee was raised. Once apogee was raised, after that, like lunar transfer trajectory, we will be transferring into Mars orbit. This was because it was Earth-centric, so it is known as geocentric phase. After geocentric phase, we have shifted to heliocentric phase and then Mars-centric phase. We went on changing the altitude, not only altitude, but eccentricity of the orbit. And we were supported by three global deep space network for that. And this is CAPTCHA. He is a Karnataka chief minister. So this is how I do the coverage. And that time Mars Orbiter was injected. Our prime minister was there with us. And it was really appreciated by Google by putting a doodle on Mars Orbiter mission. China has also given their reaction, appreciated ISRO. Pakistan also appreciated in their TV, and this was the live image on that. So I'm skipping Chandrayaan 2. This is the last video I wanted to see. Chandrayaan 2 parts and rover. It is disassembled and various payloads. So various here, and then injected. And it was about to land. And we crash landed on the moon surface in Chandrayaan 2. And based on the available models, Chandrayaan 3 also is being planned. Chandrayaan 2, based on remote sensing and techniques of imaging, digital elevation model were prepared. This is our mission control center where we sit and give commentary and we sit and do the control. Of course, our Prime Minister appreciated our efforts in Nagpur. Thank you very much. And sometimes when I come in front of you, that time I'll give you one more talk on technical side from the ISRO side. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. We know you were in immense pain, yet you are here putting up a brave face and setting the zenith of commitment. Is truly learning and inspirational for one and all presented here. The whole presentation was loaded with a lot of details related to different satellite adventure of ISRO, and we could felt the different milestones achieved by ISRO during the last 3.5 decades. The beautiful glimpses of the different missions like Chandrayaan 1 and 2, Mars Orbiter Mission, Gagan, PSLV C-337 were truly aesthetic and also gave us the moment to relive the different moments we achieved of pride. So thank you so much, sir.
Hello.
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 Can I with Aditi,
I want to say something.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Sorry. Sir, despite of so hard time, you lost your favorite fellow colleague yesterday. You are here, sir. Sir, we can feel your pain in your words. It shows your love for your fellow colleague. Sir, I knew you was very much worried about the health of your colleague, but you never say no to me for this presentation. Sir, it confirms that you are a person of commitment. Sir, you know that you was the first person whom I called as soon as we received approval of this FDP. Sir, with your help and support, we are able to get the learned faculty from IIRS Dehradun as a resource person. I must confess that this program would not be possible without your help. Sir, I would like to express my heartfelt thanks to you. You are our proud alumni, and we feel proud with your achievement. And for me, sir, you are my favorite senior. I still remember your achievements as a student. I am very fortunate to have a senior like you, sir. And it is always a great experience to listen from you. In this short lecture, sir, you have showed as a long history of ISRO. Its journey shows that there is always, if you are committed to your aim. Thank you very much. Thanks a lot,
Seema. Seema is my younger sister. I was 1 year elder to me. That time, neither I was Dr. Alok nor Seema was Dr. Seema. For me, Seema is my younger sister, like Seema earlier. I don't want to show that image today, which I had earlier when we were in both of us. We were literary committee in GCB Bilaspur.
Yes, I personally thank. I still remember. Yes, sir.
I personally thank to Seema and Chawla sir and faculty of GC Bilaspur giving me opportunity to be with my college as alumni and all the participants. All the best. Learn a lot and participate in country's growth by your skill. I am very sure these sessions will be very fruitful for all of you, and I wish all the best for all the participants. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. And we hope that you will find some comfort sooner. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you very much. Can I quit now?
Yes, sir.
Somebody wants to.
Yeah, if any queries there, one or two I can take if time permits.
Okay.
Because we are running short of time, so 10:56 in my clock, 11 o'clock was my allotted time.
Okay, there is a question from Jitin. Do you want to ask something?
I'm not able to listen you. Can you repeat the question, please?
So you are not audible. So could you please repeat your question?
Elon Musk's space explorations, are they too advanced than our ISRO's explorations, or are they just fancy stuff, sir?
I think nice question. I think I have shown you we are at par with all entire globe. And you have seen that Chandrayaan 1 itself, 11 nations came with us, and 11 scientific instruments were there. So it is not